Welcome back to another issue. I'm Beastie Boy.
I'm Table.
I'm Red.
And it is I, Shino Brando.
And in this issue, we pull a mulligan on the Justice League and come around with Zack Snyder's Justice League.
So, Zack Snyder's Justice League was released on March 18th, 2021. The screenplay was done by Chris Terrio. It was directed by Zack Snyder. It stars Ben Affleck, Henry Cavill, Gal Gadot, Ray Fisher, Jason Momoa, Ezra Miller. It had a budget of $70 million. Its runtime is a colossal 4 hours and 2 minutes. This movie stands as a monument for what fan outcry can do, as hashtag release the Snyder cut on all social media was the driving force on why this even exists in the first place. This movie is dedicated to Zack Snyder's passed on daughter, and Alison Krauss' cover of Hallelujah plays at the end as a tribute.
I mean, no one can be mad at the guy for walking away from the project given what happened. But at the same time, I think we can all agree that the Whedoning was a crime in its own right.
Yeah, we have to backtrack on that too, because I don't know, just to make sure everybody gets caught up on that as well. So go ahead.
So Zack Snyder walked away from the project of Justice League midway through because his daughter died and he decided to take some family time. And that's completely reasonable. And right. As a result, Joss Whedon got brought on the project to finish it.
And also Hank Zimmer.
Yes. And like, all right, do what you gotta do. But I think everyone agrees that the Whedon Justice League wasn't good. It was disappointing for a lot of people. And the fact that we get this second chance where we get to actually see the movie we were supposed to have. First of all, that's incredibly uncommon in cinema. Like, I actually watched a whole video essay on why the Snyder Cut would never be released, which, haha, joke's on him, I guess. Mm-hmm. Because movie production doesn't really work like that. This wasn't something that they could just stitch back together. They actually had to do a lot of work to make this movie happen the way it is.
Yeah, there's a lot of behind the scenes stuff. So, because like the general audience didn't really know what was going down, right? So you had the movie being filmed, handed by Snyder. Then you had a lot of people who had lost faith in his vision of heroes. So it looked like he got fired from a project, right? Where we didn't know that he had lost his daughter. And the news of that came out a little bit later on. So it just looked like he got replaced by Whedon. And then that project happened, right? And then we got the end result of that. And then we got news of like, you know, like Snyder had a different cut and then no one believed in that. And then we finally got movement behind it, and it happened. Again, it all reflects a lot of behind the scenes stuff with Ray Fisher as well, and our episode behind that too. So there's a lot of things going on in there that we really had no idea. And now that everything comes to light, it kind of shows you the end, you know, the end project that we got from him. You can tell it's a totally different project. So, you know, I'm happy that he was able to finish the project, put it in remembrance to his daughter, because we're in that time period. He had to let go of a dream to, you know, take care of a family. So yeah, and this is, you can tell there's a lot of heart in it. He did what he wanted to do with it. He had something in mind. He had a dream. He had a vision in it. It's finally done. So it's good to dive into this now, because the first version we got from the Justice Whedoning, we gave that one a piss poor score.
I mean, right off the bat, Jason Momoa was no longer under a weird make him paler filter, which is great.
Yep.
Yeah, so you notice that he's a shade deeper now.
Like, I swear to God, he probably looks better in black and white than he did in Joss Whedon's.
Oh, yeah. Speaking of, so I did try to go through that black and white version of, you know, Justice is Gray. Can't do it. I did it for about maybe 25, 26 minutes. It's not filmed being black and white. So it like certain scenes just don't work well in that contrast. It just doesn't work. It looks very done on green screen when it's in black and white. You can kind of just see green screen. It's just like, so it doesn't really look well. And again, it only serves the purpose of having the black borders on the side for the 4:3 ratio. So that's all it's for, because people complain that, you know, I don't want to say spoiled, but like, I don't know, 4:3 ratio didn't really bother me. And black bars are there. And
it didn't bother me either. Listen, this was definitely an artistic experience of that movie. And right. Yeah, I'm sold. Yeah.
Yeah, me too. Like, you know, in watching the color with the black bars and the black borders on the side for in that ratio didn't bother me one bit. I wasn't really focused on that. I was focused on the middle of the fucking screen anyway. So whatever, right?
Where to begin with the plot?
Don't count on it, Batman, right? Go from there.
Compared to the first act question mark of the other one, this was actually like the beginning of a story I wanted to see.
Very much so.
So yeah, the scream that heard around the world, right?
A replay of what happened in BVS, where Superman takes the kryptonite spear post his Martha scene with Batman that will never let go, and goes and kills Doomsday.
Yeah, in turn getting killed himself. scream heard around the world. Again, that was the, I guess, the marker of, oh, the great savior is gone, so now we must make our move. Right?
All hope is actually gone now.
It also made the ending of BVS have consequences in a real and very tangible way, where the intro of Justice League was like, we're sad, things are bad, and we're gonna show it to you with an angsty track playing. This was, everyone is aware that things are different now.
And this, yeah, you know, this one still keeps in the context of the story here. This is again, like you said, consequences. The Big Blue is dead now, and so now baddies can make their move. Things can now happen because the great savior is gone.
That's a lot of what Batman tries to come to terms with. It very much is a continuation of their relationship from Batman v Superman.
It helps bring gravity to the situation compared to, like, you know, the opening of Whedon's Justice League, where it's just literally Batman on a rooftop chasing down a power demon. He's just like, oh, I noticed that he's bothered by a security system sound, and so this is gonna be my weapon for later on in the movie, which is total stupid shit. That whole rooftop sequence and the whole alarm, that is completely cut from this movie. It's gone.
I think the interesting thing, right, was I can see why it was in Whedon's, because it sets up how Batman is gonna be portrayed in this film. Versus how he was in Batman versus Superman. But it was, at the end of the day, filler.
It's almost as if Whedon can't write Batman. It's like he did that scene just to say...
almost as if Whedon can't write.
Oh. Period. Right? He's like, he did that scene just to say, just to give Batman something to do later in the movie. Oh, yeah, this is how I contribute by making a sound that bothers them. Yeah. Stupid.
I know how to affect them. Yeah.
Yeah, it's dumb. We didn't need that. This movie, however, gives you something more. He's in remorse. He's mourning, and now he's got to make amends by trying to unite these people. But regarding that scene now in the bar, that has a lot more of a thicker situation in it compared to like the Whedon's cut for that. It's just a more involved.
They certainly chastise Batman a little bit more during that scene. Hey,
yeah, right. Like it seems like more of a real like conversation.
Just their first meeting, 10 times better.
Yeah, their first meeting works out way better. It doesn't. He doesn't seem. It just, you know, like Whedon's version just seemed like he just wanted to make Aquaman a hard ass for just no reason other than just being a hard ass.
Whereas this one at least gives him a reason and was like, oh, no. Like, so Joss Whedon wanted to introduce his character as very much an alcoholic, and that's the way Aquaman would solve his problems, by not and then sipping on the rest of the bottle. Whereas in this one, he only does it because he comes up for air and saves the dude.
Yeah.
Because, I would need a drink after that, too. Like, I get it, man.
Do some hard work, reward yourself.
Humanizing our characters, especially our characters of color, rather than making them lazy alcoholics or plot devices.
Thank you. Right? Ooh. Like, here it is. He's very much a person who can't involve himself in two worlds. He's not quite human. He's not quite Atlantean. He doesn't know where he wants to be, so he doesn't want to get himself involved in fucking matters. Like, this shit's crazy. He's like, nope, no thanks. I just do my bid and I go around my business and that's that, right?
I still say my favorite version of Aquaman needs to have a hook hand, but I'll die on that hill.
Would it be all right nowadays if we saw Aquaman riding a dolphin paws? I didn't think so.
No. I think we're more likely to see a dolphin riding Aquaman. But hey, speaking of Mera, her introduction in this movie is worth very little stones, and I appreciate it a lot, because in his movie, which canonically takes place after this one, he hasn't met her, and so their very limited interactions, you get to start to forgive the fact that that takes place after this one.
I'm just gonna take a point off this movie for Steppenwolf not finishing the job when he had the chance. Okay, sorry. So, you know, let's just go through the motions of the whole film as we remember them as, because going through chapters is very hard to remember.
Yeah,
it's true. Yeah, for sure.
We're limiting ourselves here. So
I want to kind of throw attention to the Amazons.
Yeah.
Of how Zack portrayed them with giving more context. My fucking God, that was a beautifully well done, by the way.
Listen, bro. So what I'm gonna say is, when that whole thing goes down, when they get challenged by Steppenwolf, when Hippolyta has to run out of the whole fucking the chamber there, right? And she's running through, and the Amazonians are just breaking down the hallway, which just uses massive hammers. Ooh, let me just tell you, by the end of that whole scene, I was just like, yo, I need a cigarette right now, man.
Remember, we got the Amazons in the original one. For those who, it's been a while, were basically portrayed as a completely ineffectual force playing keep away. So to see them. That they actually had contingencies in play. So they actually had a plan for how to deal with this. That was nice.
What I do love is that Snyder, he treats them like he did the Spartans when he did
300.
When they stand there and she's like, you know, I can taste your fear. And she's like, show them your fear. We have no fear. You fuck, bro. Light the cigarette now, dog. It's already over for me.
Like, Zach brought like the beauty of like, the heroine of the Amazonian women.
Mm-hmm.
But like, just of like, yeah, portraying of like, yeah, these warriors don't have fear. We'll show through our actions that we can fight you off or hold you off, if anything. In that sense, too, of like how, again, as you mentioned, the contingencies, like these warriors plan things ahead or have well enough plans that like, you know, work well in hand. If one thing doesn't work, we'll go to the next one. And if this one doesn't work, continue on.
Like, He wasn't ready. He wasn't ready. No. You see, he was getting frustrated. He was just like, yo, I want this done now. He was getting pissed, bro.
But Amazon's just, nope, psych, here's another one.
But I will take points off because he still continues, and it's no fault of Zack Snyder's. He still uses the same costumes as Joss Whedon did. They're not the Wonder Woman ones.
For those unfamiliar, those costumes are simply skimpy warrior women rather than actually semi-practical warrior women outfits, and we do not stand.
Let's move on from there. I think they lose the mother box, and so they have to light the arrow to alert Wonder Woman that shit's going down.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So they light the fire of man or something like that, and Diana goes to Bruce after finding that. And after it being like national news, it's like, yeah, hey, this fire has been on for about a day and a half. But then Wonder Woman goes and she finds the prophecy underneath where the arrow is. And that there is our first glimpse of our real villain, Darkseid.
Dun, dun, dun. Wow, so are we having proper context?
Oh, shit, dude.
Love to see it.
Having Darkseid being this looming thing and then having to have that entire flashback to the original battle on Earth. C'est magnifique, my guy.
Yeah, I know. The transition between and giving you the backstory of how it went down. I know. It gave you everything you were looking for in a whole scene, man. And like, Heike, I wanted that to be at the end of the movie, too. I wanted Darkseid there, man. I mean, we'll get to that, too. Yeah, that whole sequence was pretty large, grand in scope, and Ares is a badass, man.
And also, a Green Lantern, but for realsies. It's like he heard my calling for it. We talked about in our original episode of like how much like of a cock tease that Green Lantern shit was. No. This time we saw the whatever alien Green Lantern was there. Only one showed up, but that's neither here nor there, I guess. And like Diana,
you're terrible at prioritizing.
It's true. Diana straight up mentions that like heroes from the stars. And I'm like, there's definitely only one hero. But if the legend says heroes, I guess that's the way you would be told that. Fair enough, I'll write it off. But we also see him die and his ring go somewhere else. Perfect. That's all I wanted.
That's what you're getting, exactly.
I still don't get that the box of man is just buried in a hole somewhere.
Fuck, dude.
That's still dumb to me, but you know what? In context, I now get it.
Everyone else went, we're going to protect it. And man went, man sucks at protecting things. We're putting it in a hole. And they were right.
No, like, you know how, like, look at the elaboration, right? Like, the Atlanteans are like, you know, we have this Kraken creature, we keep it in this chamber, we have it protected. The Amazonians, same thing, they make this chamber, and they have it guarded, and we have these badass guards.
We have protected the roof for, like, everything, and then...
Right, man, dig a hole. Put it in my backyard, man. In fact, you know what? If you were smart, you'd just give that, you'd get two boxes to the Amazonians, and it'd been double safe, kind of.
She, kind of.
Yeah, it was it was safer in fucking Themyscira than it was in a fucking hole. And then it lands in the hands of Silas Stone. And boy, oh boy, do we get the best interpretation of Cyborg on screen ever.
Compared to the first time around, the remix was a lot better, right?
The remix was actually something.
Right, exactly.
It's like, I'm a monster. No. This is why he's a monster.
And it's crazy that his role got limited to what it was in the first cut because they were afraid to market angry black man. I don't know where you live, my friend, but in America, there seems to be a lot of angry black men. So,
speak on it.
So I don't know why you want to dumb it down to just this stock character that you want to force to scream out booyah because it's a fucking funny character to you. Because what? What was the reason? And so here we have Ray Fisher actually in a role where it matters. And lo and behold, the guy can fucking act.
Wow, it's like he knew what he was doing the whole time.
My God. He showed a range of emotion of angry, upset, crying, holding back happiness because he feels he's outcasted by being this cyborg monster. And yet, you didn't get that in the first time around. It was just this cutout that was terrible.
Yeah.
And you could feel it on screen too, because you can see he's not happy doing what he's doing on screen. Most of the scenes from that first cut never made it into this cut. I wonder why.
With this obvious reveal of like showing the proper, you know, cyborg story, it also shows like, you know, the proper interaction with his relationship with his parents, especially with his mom, which we didn't even see the first time. That's what we needed to see. We needed to understand like what was happening between him and his dad and understand why the relationship was better with his mom on that side. Mm-hmm. And so we got to see that developed and spun out, and then like, okay, this happened to the mom, okay, and then now he has to rely on his dad, has to build that connection.
You appreciate the backstory because they actually built on something. Mm-hmm. And not just insert for reasons, or I hate to say it, insert for demographic reasons.
If you can. Yeah.
Let's all be honest with ourselves. Cyborg and Whedon's cut was just plot device guy who had angst that we weren't going to explore.
100%.
Mm-hmm.
Here we looked into that angst and went, oh, actually, damn, what a tragedy, though. For real.
Yeah.
Like, right. Damn, dude, you got something to cry about now. I get it.
Yeah. Vic Stone is interesting. Oh, my God. Who knew?
Back to the plot. We have the creation of Cyborg and the continued elaboration of Silas's attempt to make a sliver of a connection with his son. Yeah. And I think one of the most powerful moments in how that's exemplified, like just up to 11, is with the recorder.
Oh yeah, man. All that was, you can tell that was a father-son message.
Like, hardcore. Holy shit.
Yeah, yeah. It came from the heart, and you can feel it. They gave Vic some love, man. Finally, you get to see something with him. But with Cyborg, you got some kind of buildup. With Flash, you got a bit of a buildup too. And I like the way they threw him in to insert him in his scene, man.
100%. His initial.
Oh man, it's so good.
I believe that's where the plot even takes us next. So let's go there. Ezra Miller's Flash was the other character in Joss Whedon's Justice League that got absolutely sidelined. This one, the first time we as the audience see him. He's applying for jobs. He's trying to get something so he can pay for it. It's another dad situation. His dad is locked up for the murder of his mom that he very much did not commit. But only Barry seems to believe that that's true. Barry is trying to fund himself in like degrees and get a job and to help himself so he can help his dad. Like, this is another dad relationship, and it speaks in dynamic to Cyborg and his dad.
One of the things that I found was arguably one of the better criticisms of Ezra's Flash was just how much it pulls on the CW Flash and some of the dynamics that didn't exist until that show for Barry Allen as a character. But like recontextualizing all of that in this cut, actually, yeah, okay, I can still see this as Mr. Barry Allen, one of the bluest lanterns to ever lantern when that one came up. Like, about hopefulness and optimism, and at the same time doing the right thing even when it fucking sucks.
Immediately after applying for a job, this dude, and it is, to me, it's one of the two best effects in this entire movie, where he spins around in his shoes, breaks them apart, like molecularly destroys them to go save Iris, now in a car crash.
It only makes sense that his material would not last.
So now we've introduced a handful of characters. Where are we going?
Where do we go from here? There's so much that happens in this movie. So
I believe this is now after Diana talks about that. We get two character introductions. Now we see Steppenwolf take the first mother box and talk to Desaad.
Desaad. Mm-hmm. That's it. Yeah. I'm just going to put it out there that Steppenwolf is this big medicine guy, but he's got some adorable eyes. He looks like Grumpy Cat.
He does, too. You're so right, and I hate it, but I love it.
I wasn't the only one who was bothered by that, because I like...
He was so adorable, wanted to pet him. Look at his eyes, man.
He just wanted his dad's approval again.
Dad, if I kill this planet, can we go get McDonald's?
I'm starting to see a running theme of daddy issues here.
Yes.
Zack Snyder, have you got something you want to talk to us about?
No, this but anyway, so a second mother box. The fight in Atlantis. I'll admit, that plays very similarly to how that original fight went. It plays it out. But the conversation between Aquaman and Mara in that little bubble, good. Nice.
Yeah.
Solid. Yeah. Nothing to complain about, honestly.
In this film, though, get to finally see where he gets his goddamn his mother's trident and armor from, because it makes more sense, and then just
up
with it. A whole lot of stuff being cut from this version that just that made that whole movie, that first version, just really bad. And now they're getting, like I told you guys before, when they first came out and we were watching us, it's like it's all context, just it adds more to everything and makes everything make more sense. And that, even the little things, just like showing me where he gets his weapon and armor from, you know, it makes more sense than other than him just showing up with it and then never shows up again with it ever again in the following movie.
What's really interesting, right, is just when you go, okay, we've got a 4-hour version of this movie that you've already seen, you go, oh god, what? But there's a lot of stuff that this movie actually cut. Like, it's 4 hours of different content, not just 4 hours of rehashed or extended content.
That's it, yeah.
Yes, that's what I would say also, is that go into this movie, watch a YouTube video on the first one, then go into this one with context of like what that movie didn't bring and the experience that you're actually getting out of this one. Right. So now we have Diana with the third mother box. How did she get it again?
They dug it out of a hole.
Yes.
So I believe Silas had it. He brought it home and they had it in their closet. And then Vic took it and decided to go bury it at his own grave to hide it again because the power demons were coming around.
Because he is a little bit of a sad boy, let's be honest.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
He's got reason to be. Don't get me wrong. But like, he's a little bit.
Of course.
He's a sad boy.
You know, Steppenwolf searches for the third one and they grab Silas's dad from his own apartment. And so Cyborg shows up and he sees the bat signal. So, of course, he goes and grabs his fucking mother box and goes and shows himself on the rooftop. After the initial meeting of getting these guys together finally, right? And this is now mission one of Justice League. Sans Superman.
And then it's, let's go get Superman, which I like me some Kryptonian lore. Amazing. Listen, pardon me for saying, but I'm going to suck the dick for the rest of this movie. Because, like, the return of Superman, this version of it, like, I'm going to use this word again, masterful.
I think we have to remember again that the decision to put the return of Superman in this movie was weird as fuck. Like, that's the kind of thing that deserves its own movie, generally speaking. However,
it has three.
Where it was so poorly done in the Whedoning that you kind of go, this is a crime. At least Snyder didn't do it poorly.
No.
He made a weird decision to do it here, but given the end of Batman versus Superman, they had to if they wanted Superman in this fucking movie. So I get it. And yeah, he did a good enough job with it that I didn't hate watching it this time around.
With this one, it gave you consequence of waking Superman up from the dead, right?
Yeah.
You had two consequences. You had what Cyborg saw, and then you had the aftermath of when he actually woke up and he was not in his right mind, right? Whipping the fucking ass everywhere, right? It adds to it more. Again, the whole sequence of just even getting that mother box and that whole fight is just different too. Aquaman coming through the tunnel was different as well. Like the whole thing was just a whole lot different that it just made it that much better.
It made more sense. It just did. Like obviously straight up, like you see it and it's like, this, I understand it. Okay. They have this power. Cool.
Waking him up, the consequences of that happening. And even that fight in the park runs off a bit different as well. The confrontation with Batman, you know my favorite thing, on site, right? When he catches notice of Bruce, of, you know, Batman on field, man, you see how quick his head snaps towards him? He's like, I'm gonna murder you, man.
You're
invited this fucking guy.
Still love that fight against Superman. Even in the Whedon version, I just like seeing Superman being challenged by his own teammates.
Yeah.
Because it's a spectacle, man. You know what I mean? I just like seeing it happen. What I don't like, though, is that in times of crisis here, but they're about to get their asses handed in by Superman, they refuse to call him by any other name other than fucking Clark and give this guy's alias away. They keep calling this guy Clark in front of cops, even. Yeah. And there's Lois Lane, who's on site, who you know either works with either Clark Kent, who is very close to Superman. Someone out there's got to be able to put two and two together, man.
It's not complicated math. I think this is 1+1, in fact. They are calling him Clark in front of recordings.
But once Superman takes Lois and they go to the Kent farm, and we have a reason to have actually had Ma Kent there.
Yes.
No fucking context.
No
weird upper
lip moments.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Going to the farm and having him have his memories restored one bit by bit was like just warming, man, because like it's like watching this guy being born again.
Which definitely helps with the Christ allegory he goes for.
And the scenery of having him in the cornfield, man. Right. And because like the way they have the Kent farm set up with the sunset and everything, it's just an immaculate shot.
Yeah. I will say, while we're talking about Superman and Clark Kent and that together, this movie made Henry Cavill Superman my Superman. I'm in. I'm sold.
Yeah. You know,
I was definitely a Christopher Reeve guy.
Me too.
And like, you know, I could put up with the other Superman that have existed in Smallville. But now that I watched him come back from the dead and I watched his humanity come back and he needs to exist both halves again. And it's not a baby like he was in Man of Steel. I'm in. I'm sold. Context, I guess. Having Ma Kent show up to pull Amy Adams' Lois Lane off of her knees, basically. And then, in the best twist it could have had, turns out to be Martian Manhunter all along.
Which we finally get our glimpse of, finally, right? After mentioning, after so many years. What do you think of his look? What do you think?
Cool. Yeah. Definitely, in fact, Martian Manhunter in live action. No qualms about it.
I was going to say the same thing. It's exactly what it's something I would think a Martian would look like if you took that from the print and put it on screen. He translates well to me.
Let's jump our way. I know we're skipping a lot, but anything between here and the final battle we want to talk about?
No, I mean, other than resurrecting Superman, that movie does flow out potentially almost the same way, right? They now have to make their final attack against Steppenwolf. They know the area. Got the battle plans figured out.
Yeah.
Bruce is just banking on the fact that Superman will show up, right?
The thing that we do got to mention, though, is every time Steppenwolf gets a mother box and inputs it into, you know, MacGuffin pillar.
I'm going to say the obelisk, but I don't know.
Good enough. Yeah. Obelisk sure works. Obelisk, the Tormentor.
I could have sworn that was part of the source wall. That was my head. That's where my head went to.
Sure. Maybe? I'll take that. Not only do we get better and more clear images of exactly what Darkseid's going to look like later in the movie, but we also see why that looks purple and how the infection that would take over the Earth actually grows as a base for him, and why he chose that as a base in the first place.
Like Zerg creep, but Steppenwolf edition.
Before we quickly, I guess, go to the main fight scene, I think the one scene where we skipped, kind of, where they were saving Silas and the group of scientists and all that, like the people, with the Flash, where basically when they were bringing out the civilians and Flash basically, like, I don't know what you would call it, but super, like, super dashed and say, like, push all those, like, with rocks.
With the falling debris? Yeah.
Yes.
When he's overhead? That was
the sickest shit.
Big ups to Barry Allen in the Snyderverse. He's big on yoga. I'm giving him that. Yo, my dude always looked cool on screen, man. I'll give him that.
Man is stretching
100%.
Barry says there's always one thing he's not supposed to do, and he fucking does it twice in this movie. The man's reversing time.
So here we
pulling it backwards. Yeah, man.
Before we go to that, just remember that on that stone in the park when Clark was catching up to Barry, that they did like a little hint to Ben Parker, which, again, I don't know.
They did too. And I was confused. It literally is sitting in the memorial from the death of Superman. It's etched in there, Ben Parker. And I'm like, really? You done this? You done this to me? You're going to make my brain think about this?
That's the only thing. I was just like, the fuck?
Oh, it just hit me why that's there. It just hit me. Oh, all right, strap in, boys and girls. So, in the Marvel universe, right, your characters are very much world outside your window, right?
Okay.
This might be a show that's like, oh, no. We are not playing in a reality. We're playing in my reality. So this is why we get to kill Ben Parker. But even though Ben Parker is dead, this is not a place for superheroes of that kind.
Really, sticking by that one rule, you know, the two things that must be true in any comic that exists. Lex Luthor is bald and it's Superman's fault. And Uncle Ben is dead.
10-4 table.
Yeah. Damn.
The two fundamental truths.
Let's accelerate ourselves to the final battle.
When they're resurrecting Superman, Barry tells him straight up, he can do something. He can make something happen. He can generate electricity, breaking one rule he's not supposed to do. He can make the mother box talk and get this thing going, right? And you quite literally see him run, and he breaks it by having time start moving backwards on itself, right? The mother box is dipping into the fucking fluid, and it comes right back out. You get an idea that now Flash is like, he can really, it's more than just running fast. He can kind of motion time, in a sense.
It's also, you start to see it as a Chekhov's gun. He can run real fast and he has these rules, but why bring up these rules if we're not gonna break them?
That's it, right? But yeah, now that we're here at the final battle, the whole thing looked badass as fuck. What'd you guys think?
Can I second that with a fuck yes and 100%?
I'm in on a 200%, my guy. The fact that all these heroes show up and do a really good job, a tactical job, not like the first time round where it's like, I don't know, jump in, I guess. like hero landing, here we go.
Mm-hmm.
No, this is a tactical job. You go high, we're going low. This is the way we're going in. Batman's on his own, going to shoot the piss out of everything. It's great.
Pillar has got to go down. The pillar's the weak point. We break that down. We break down the barrier. We can get inside and start taking down Steppenwolf. They had a plan. They had everything, man. Still going to say that it looks much better in the way it looks with the dark skies. The red sky contrast in the first film was bullshit. It looked fucking awful. Don't know why Whedon decided to turn the sky red and make it look like it's like a really
when the base was
green.
Purple.
Exactly. It makes no sense.
Evil, evil fruit.
It's terrible. He wanted everything to look like a pack of nerds candy. It's terrible, man. Here, the lighting is perfect. It's dark. It's you know, we have storm clouds. We have everything happening here. It's a dark situation. It looks better. It didn't look fraud, man. Still going to put it out there.
It gives that grittiness that is needed for, for the setting.
You are dealing with the end of the world and the new gods and Darkseid and Steppenwolf and all of their nonsense.
Yeah, emphasis on Darkseid because that motherfucker is, as you said, Red, looming into this, like, this part of the world.
I'm still going to put it out there for Aquaman taking to the skies against the power demons, getting thrown off, getting caught by Cyborg, getting thrown into a power demon, and then surfing the fucker right down to the ground.
Still badass, Loki.
Dope.
Fucking
200%
yo, dude,
dope.
So cool. Still the baddest scene, bro. I don't care.
I'm glad that one stayed.
He surfed him. Stupid. It's stupid, but it worked.
But it's so good. It's very Aquaman, though, right? Yeah. It's very him.
And yeah, man, just that whole shot of them, you know, brushing in, and you have that still panel of the whole, you know, the whole crew.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot believe that Zack Snyder pulled off what is very much a Joss Whedon type shot, like action shot with all the players on board, better than the man who does it in every movie he's ever done. But as we need to do, we still have one more player on this board that doesn't show up yet. So we have to put our characters in a space that Superman, in his second most iconic costume, the black one, the best one in my opinion. Well, like best alternate costume. Like Superman costume, you can't beat and I'll die on that hill.
A real look and a half.
Correct. His walk through his Kryptonian ship and to see the other armors that are there in the other suits, I'm like, that's that, and that's that, and that's that. He got me.
Oh, dude.
Zack Snyder got me.
I don't know about you, but that same shot you're talking about with the walkthrough where he's got the costume on, I don't know about you, but it's the vocals of having John, Kent, and Joel talk.
Yeah.
That got it for me for that scene. You know, inspiring their son to take flight again. That gave me goosebumps all the way around.
Yeah.
And then
yes. You
see it put in motion, right? Because
yes. Superman shows
in,
up.
Man, oh boy.
Oh, I had to assume like a better seat as I was watching this and go like, okay, Steppenwolf is about to get his horned ass handed to him.
Eat.
Like they're trying to separate the mother boxes. They're doing their thing, man. Steppenwolf is about to like come in and strike Cyborg down, and Superman just comes out of nowhere. He's just like, not impressed, man.
You do see me? Do you know who I am? Like
axe hits his shoulders. Just like,
do you see this S?
First and foremost, so the running joke in my family when it comes down to Superman is that it's Superman. Everybody else's powers to him should just be, it's below him, right? Like, he should be just completely ignorant to, like, what you can do because he's fucking Superman, right? It's just like, when he got struck by Steppenwolf, he should have been like, and your powers are what? What is this?
Yeah.
Is that all you can do? Like,
and that's exemplified by having Steppenwolf take a swing at him with an axe and Superman basically shrugging it off his shoulder and saying, that's all you got? My turn?
This is it? Yeah, freezes it, shatters it, and sort of proceeds to beat the ass that is Steppenwolf. Clark went like he exemplifies the Boy Scout in the fact that like he bullies. So like when he fucking tossed Steppenwolf into a wall and then punched this guy right back down to the ground, dude proceed to punch him in his chest and then stand there and hover over him like with his foot on his chest, like, and then proceed to use the heat vision to sever his horn off. Well, it's like Clark, man. He, look at his eyes. He's already whimpering. Stop.
Like, you beat the dude while he's down, but, like, I get it. He's threatening your whole planet. And he deserves an extra couple lickings for that, but...
The funny thing is, for that scene, as soon as he got close, like, bringing more impact on punching Steppenwolf, it was such, like, an anime scene where he's like, man, yo, Clark, you good, my guy? You're going a bit hard. Like, Clark, yo, hey, Clark, he's done.
Like, he's had enough. He's down. So... As this ass whooping of a lifetime is currently going on for Steppenwolf, Cyborg is failing to separate the three mother boxes. And real quick, before we jump to the rest of the plot, having them have a name and a backstory on why these three mother boxes, like, that was my original gripe with the original Justice League. But now, amends, here it is. I respect it.
Well, Red, this was supposed to be our bridge to the new Gods movie that just got canceled, man. They were going to use... This was Zack Snyder stuff was part of a Bible that was going to be whole lore.
I know.
And they took it away from us, man.
Sucks. But Cyborg failed.
They all failed.
Right.
Flash got taken out, yeah.
Because Flash basically trips.
Well, he doesn't trip. He gets a shot to the side cage, man. Right? So he's got to heal up a little bit. And he's freaking him out because it's like he hasn't taken a serious injury yet. But yeah, the plan doesn't work. Mother boxes kind of explode. And the gang gets fried. But I'll let Red finish this one off because I know he likes the scene.
But in the completion of the Chekhov's gun from earlier, we break this rule again with Barry Allen. It's my favorite scene. It's my favorite CGI anything in this whole show. Barry Allen stepping close to the speed of light, exceeding it, going faster than, and reversing time. Dope.
And the only thing that kind of like threw me off a little bit was just like the, I guess, running stance of like Ezra's
way he runs.
Yeah. Which,
yeah, it's a little goofy, but you know.
Ezra does not run like someone used to running. I don't know what's
up. Ezra, you're looking a little funny right there, but.
I mean, I'll say that I appreciate them bringing in the time elements with him, given that the Flash movie is going to be Flashpoint-ish.
Mm-hmm.
Because, yeah, we need to establish not only is he capable of doing this, but also it's worked in the past.
Yeah.
Like, I can't imagine someone goes, I have time travel powers. Let's go save my dead mom. Just like right off the cuff. But he's fucked around four now. He's done it and it's been okay. So, yeah, I can see him going, maybe bigger things are also okay.
But with the Scarlet Speedster reversing time and putting things back to the way they were with a couple changes, like this time, we're winning this fight. And we are taking the head of Steppenwolf, slicing it clean the fuck off, and sending it back to Darkseid as a message.
Yeah, so let's look. Steppenwolf's all like, and then he gets a fucking trident through the fucking chest from behind, bro. And then Superman's just like, I'll do this. And then Flashman just punches the guy off the fork. And then Wonder Woman's like, no, I got this. And then she just jumps
up
and takes off the fucking head. And I'm like, whoa, guys.
Oh, man.
New meaning to the phrase, if it's worth doing, it's worth overdoing.
She made sure to send the message. And Darkseid's just like, well, I didn't like him anyways. And the portal closes and we call it a day.
I've seen a lot of criticism that, like, how come Darkseid didn't just step through? And here's my argument. Ready? Steppenwolf's battle was not over yet. No, and Steppenwolf was still proving himself. If Darkseid steps in, what does that prove?
That Steppenwolf's a little bitch, which we found out anyway.
And so when that portal closes and Darkseid is still on his apocalyptic side, that's what that proved.
But to even, like, boost on Red's point, like, it was more in a sense of, like, hey, Steppenwolf is doing his business. He's still got to prove himself. Once he does that, then we'll see what happens. Steppenwolf dead. And then Darkseid was like, yo, fuck this shit, man. I'm coming with a gang, too.
No, like, the head came off, and he stepped on it and crushed it. And he was like, who is this again? Whatever. Let's just get the armada. Let's go home.
Yeah.
Everything was great about that. I did like seeing them, you know, stand together, looking to, you know, at a new dawn, as it would be.
There's some, like, in our, like, closing little bit of the movie proper, before we get to the epilogue, seeing Batman return to what was his childhood home and being like, oh no, this is where the Justice League home is going to be. I'm like, I need that. I need to see what that looks like for this Batman. Damn it.
They're not doing Watchtower. They're going to play up on the Super Friends and give you the Hall of Justice.
That's fine by me. Friends? That's where I first messed most of these guys. That's full circle for my dumbass.
And that would have been great, but we're not getting that. You know what else we're not going to get? Because Mr. Look Badass, Joe Mangiello as Deathstroke. We're not getting that either.
Oh, yeah. He's cool.
He looks rad, but we're not getting that movie, man. We're not getting that movie. We're supposed to have a Bruce Wayne, the Ben Affleck's Bruce Wayne and Joe Mangiello Deathstroke, like, you know, face each other. We're not getting that film.
It's true. We've got one last thing of this movie to chat about, and that is the epilogue. I don't like it. I think it's a waste of my time.
I don't mind it. I don't mind it at all.
May I ask why you don't like it?
For sure. So that movie was done. And even when Martian Manhunter comes to talk to Bruce Wayne and says like, oh yeah, there's a big battle coming. Like, okay, there's a big battle coming. But now you have set this up. That's fine. You can drop hints that a big thing has come. To then take that and say the battle has come, you didn't see it, fuck you. And this is the aftermath from that big battle. And now Superman's evil. I took that as a spit in the face.
Right off.
Yeah. Well, we're not, well, because we're not getting that follow up, right? And,
yeah.
And you know what? But you know what? I take it because, like, yeah, I would do it too because, hey, man, if people talk, right? And if enough push can happen, you never know. That ending could make people want the hashtag restore the Snyderverse, right? You never know. And that shit can have some sway at one point and they're kind of forced to restore it. So, I mean, you can leave that as a bookmark, and mm-hmm. maybe one day, if you know, the cowards become not cowards anymore, maybe we can go back.
I mean, at this point, it's possible.
Maybe if we promised them enough money.
So for me, I would have dropped
that, yeah.
I would have dropped it too. I'd have been like, here, this is what you would have been getting. So take it up with them, and then maybe one day they'll listen, and then let me come back. There you go.
Besides the whole Martian Manhunter scene, which, again, kind of just laid on them, my guy, like, there's a fight going on. You could have joined. Nonetheless, yep. just with that... With that setup of a scene, like, yeah, sure, it's like it is like obviously set up for something better or possible to see again what could have happened. But yeah, as we mentioned, the big people, the big honchos were like, we're not going anymore with this, just do what you want. And he's like, okay. And then if the fans want more, which the fans have wanted more, they can do that.
But these are also the fans that are review bombing every other movie that WB puts out to say hashtag restore the Snyderverse. And I think that's a really shitty way to do that.
That is also very true, though.
Yeah, but you can't control the fans. That's them, man.
And if you are that person, get the fuck out of here.
We've said it before, exactly. And we'll say it again. Creators should be able to tell the story they set out to tell without fans being dicks about it.
Mm-hmm.
And that... The initial point was shipping related, but that extends to whatever this is as well. Like, yeah, Zack Snyder set up some stuff, but like at the end of the day, he told the story he came here to tell, and that's over now. Deal with it.
That's it.
Or it's as over as it's gonna be.
I mean, it's sad that there's no DCEU as a whole, like the MCU has it. Well, at least we have some entries in there, some good, some not.
But
I
hey,
guess when we, yeah,
on
when,
that. When
we, yeah, I was about to say, once we get to the other ones, we'll judge those. But here, we have this one, so... Mm-hmm.
So, as a refresher, what we do with these DC movies is we tend to rank them. And so, at the very bottom, we've got Suicide Squad at a 2 out of 10. Batman vs. Superman at 3 out of 10. Aquaman at 4.5 out of 10. Man of Steel is a 6 out of 10. Shazam is... 7. Birds of Prey, we had an approximate average. That's the one we had to do an approximate average for. Was 7.5, and at the very top of the list was Wonder Woman at a perfect 10 out of 10.
Oh, and then we still got to do WW84. And
so, my question to you all is, out of 10, where do we score it?
I kind of want to say an 8.
I respect your 8, but I say a 9.
I want to take points off for it being long as fuck, I'll be honest. And that's a personal thing where, like, there's only so much of a movie I can sit through before I want to start, like, eating my coffee table, and this was pushing my luck on that one. But yeah, I also respect your 9. So if the rest of you guys feel more 9 than 8, then I'm with it.
Sorry, we're just breaking a metaphor of like table eating a table, really?
Cannibalism.
You are what you eat.
Yeah, that's about to say it, man.
Funny thing is, like, I agree with both points because, like, this as I mentioned throughout this whole like obviously discussion, this was like so much better than what we got from Joss Whedon's reckoning of whatever that movie was, but I might just be the middleman and be like an 8.5 or just, I don't know, if anything, I'll lean, because like it's good, it's like well done of what we needed to see. And for me, as like as being the DC moderate fan out of the whole group here, this was much better and what I want to see of like context and understanding. Okay, this can do this, this person has this abilities, the connection of like, you know, characters coming together is well done, and this was that movie. So even if we got like a 2-hour version of all this together, it still would have been way better to see, not alone. And then we get like this director version sent out later. So I said like an 8.5.
This movie could not be done in just 2 hours.
100%. In fact, to jump on that, I believe within the next 5 to 7 years. Because, right, you couldn't release this in theaters regularly. Had, you know, the Backstreet Boys not be continuing their parade here, a 4-hour cut would have hit very limited theaters in the first place.
Mm-hmm. No, I don't say it, though, because we've had stuff like fucking the extension of Lord of the Rings in there. People sat down for 5 hours to watch Malcolm X. So, I mean, a lengthy movie is not a problem. We've done 3-hour movies already, so we can do an extra hour. It's no big deal. fuck, that's what intermissions are for. So again, this story could have been a story in 4 hours, and that's fine by me. Film wise, compared to the first look, it's way better. Movie scores points on having all that more context in there, so you gave me a much more fuller story. And I honestly feel like that may have been why his other entries may have suffered. I think Zack Snyder pens a whole lot of stuff, and it can't be filmed within the time span that he needs it. I feel like Man of Steel should have been longer, as well as Batman versus Superman.
Yeah, now I want a remix version of that one.
Because honestly, I believe those movies, the way this movie flowed and everything it was built off of from the first entries feels like the other entries should have been longer, just to give you a bit more context. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, I think even there's an ultimate edition of BV or Batman versus Superman, which is, you know, gives you a bit more story into it. So it gives you a little bit more, but I still think it suffered from not being able to tell its full story. Here, this one told the full thing. I feel like I think you get your money's worth out of it. In the efforts that he gave us, I'm gonna sit there at would I watch it a third time? No. I've already absorbed it twice. Where does it stand against the other movies in its ladder here? I'm gonna put it underneath Wonder Woman, man. I'm gonna put it at a solid 9. Because it takes balls to put out a 4-hour film like that, and in 4 hours you could have told a bullshit story, none of it worked, and none of it connected, and yet in 4 hours I had a full story and I didn't feel bored. I didn't feel like I have to turn away, or honestly, I did acknowledge the movie's 4 hours long, but I didn't feel the 4 hours. I just noticed the sunset, and that's about it.
Yeah, at halfway through, I'm like, oh, we've still got halfway through this movie, and then that last half just burned by.
Yeah, man. So solid 9. I can't give it a perfect 10 because there are some parts in that movie that could be cut away. Like the very lengthy singing when Aquaman decides to swim off again away from Bruce Wayne. That could have been cut a little bit more. There's just a few things that could have been cut that you don't really need. But I mean, it's art. So I mean, he left it in there. So 9.
There's also, you know, vestiges of the Justice League that might not have bothered me if I hadn't seen that movie.
Mm-hmm.
But having seen that movie and then watching this one, I was like, bad. I know what that is, you know?
Yeah.
So I didn't appreciate their presence.
Yeah.
If you guys 9. Are feeling up in the 9 range, I'm okay with jumping up.
Smells like that's a 9 then.
I guess so.
All right.
Hey, look at that Snyder, 3 times the charm. You got it.
Exactly. You reached an apex in a movie.
4 hours.
But hey, Beastie, I believe it's that time.
Ooh, we are done with this crusade of an adventure. Well, you know, the DCEU per se of what we got. But thankfully for Zack Snyder's talent, we were able to get something that was beautifully done. But if you would like to hear more discussions about other stuff, you make sure you subscribe and follow us for more videos. We upload every Wednesday, and you can catch us streaming live on Thursdays at twitch.tv/NerdCrusade. You can follow us on Twitter and Instagram for updates on more with, you know, some other discussions, and join our Crusader chat on Discord. The links are on screen and in the description. You can download any previous episodes or listen on your mobile device through anchor.fm or search NerdCrusade on your favorite podcast app. Thank you for joining us, and until next time, fellow Crusaders.
And that's to be continued.
Thanks for tuning in. If you like this video, go ahead and button mash the thumbs up. If you want to swing by when we have a new video, web up the sub button. Oh, and while you're at it, hit the bell to be notified by.